connection to start. Okay, we are live. Hopefully it will work out. Sorry about this bad color exposure. Okay, good morning everyone. We are alive. So welcome to another Exploring Human Anatomy with Dr. Yogesh lectures. And this lecture is for BSc nursing students. Today I'm going to discuss the reproductive system, particularly the male reproductive system. I'll start today, and later on we'll discuss the female reproductive system. And if I'm able to complete the male reproductive system today, because that is a slightly longer lecture, I hope I can finish it within one class. Otherwise we'll split and continue in the next class. So welcome again. Let's begin. So, as you are aware, we are going to discuss anatomy of certain organ systems. Like we generally teach medical students in a regional way. We don't teach systems together for medical students. So for you nursing students, we generally tend to take classes in systems, because you don't need that an elaborate understanding of anatomy. So hopefully we can cover all the organs that are involved or part of the male reproductive system today. So the male reproductive system So the male reproductive system is organ system that is closely related to the urinary system in males. Okay, and the urethra part in the male urinary system or reproductive system is common for both reproduction as well as for urination. So it is part of the urinary and genital systems, and male reproductive system includes external and internal genitalia. Okay. The external genital organs include the penis, the scrotum, the two testes. A singular testis is written as testis. Okay, when you are referring to one testis, it is testis, but when you are referring to both the testis, it is testes, but it is both of them are pronounced as testis. Okay, and there are two epididymi. Okay, or epididymis is one on one side, which goes from the testis up to the penis, and or basically to the seminal vesicles, testis to seminal vesicles. There is a tube which connects, which is called the epididymis, and the spermatic cords are the cord of structures which include the epididymis along with some other structures like the or the vas deferens, then the pampiniform plexus of veins and testicular vein and the nerves. Then these are the parts of the or structures which are included in the external genital organs. And internal genital organs include the vas deferens or ductus deferens, seminal vesicles, ejaculatory duct, prostate gland and the urethra. Okay, so this is a cut section. It's a mid-sagittal section. This kind of a section, when you take a section through the exact midpoint of the person, that's called a mid-sagittal section. This is a cross-sectional anatomy. Okay, and this section shows that there is a testis here, and from the testis there is a tube which is going up. The initial part is called the epididymis, and then which continues as epididymis is collection of multiple tubes which come and join together and ultimately form a single tube, and it is all coiled up, and then it becomes straight cord like structure which is called the vas deferens, which goes like this and comes behind the urinary bladder and joins with the seminal vesicles, and the duct of the seminal vesicle and the vas deferens which is joined it together form a single tube which goes and joins or passes through the prostate to join the urethra within the substance of the prostate, and from there the urethra continues and traverses the pelvic diaphragm and the pelvic floor and enters the penis and opens to outside at the external urethral orifice or the external urethral meatus in the penis or the glands of the penis. So that is just a general overview, a brief overview of the male reproductive system. Okay, so these are the structures. This is the testis, and that is the epididymis, and this is the vas deferens. Then you have the seminal vesicles here, and ejaculatory duct, prostate gland, urethra, which is divided into prostatic urethra, membranous urethra, and the penile urethra. And the urethra lies in the central smaller median spongy tissue of the penis, which is called the corpus spongiosum, and it dilates at the end and it opens outside to the environment at the external urethral orifice, and this structure is the penis. So that is the male reproductive system. So in this diagram you can see structures are labeled. So that is a testis, and the covering of the testis is called the scrotum, and within the testis there are seminiferous tubules which produce the spermatozoa. Okay, and that's the epididymis, and from the epididymis you will have the vas deferens going up and coming behind the bladder to the seminal vesicles. Okay, and then the ejaculatory duct, prostate gland, urethra. There are bulbo urethral glands which also join the urethra. Then that is a corpus cavernosum. The central part is a corpus spongiosum, and that is urethra opening out at the urethral orifice in the glands of the penis, and covering of the glands is the foreskin. The skin that is that covers the glands is the foreskin. Coming to individual parts of the male reproductive system, first is penis. Penis is derived from a Latin word which means tail, and it is the male organ of copulation or basically sexual intercourse. Copulation means sexual intercourse, and males use this organ for penetration, and along with copulation the penis is also responsible for conducting urine from the bladder to the outside. because major portion of the urethra lies in the penis, and urethra is part of both the urinary system as well as the male reproductive system. And the penis as such is mainly for reproduction or sexual intercourse. It is cylindrical in shape and consists of root or attached portion, and then there is a body or free portion, and it is formed by the three cylindrical masses of erectile tissue and a little bit of involuntary muscle. The erectile tissue is supported by fibrous tissue that surrounds these erectile tissue, and it is covered by skin, and it has rich blood supply, and the erectile tissue has spaces in it which are called venous sinuses, which when filled up with blood result in erection of the penis. Okay, and there are two dorsolateral masses on either side which are called corpora cavernosa penis, and the smaller midline ventral part or midventral mass is called the corpus spongiosum. Midventral means it is on the lower aspect, or when you hold the penis, on the part which is on the lower aspect of the penis, that is a corpus spongiosum. Okay, and that contains spongy urethra and keeps it open during ejaculation. So that is a penis. It has a free part and an attached part of the root. So attached part of the penis is called the root of the penis, which is made up of the two ischiocavernosus muscles as well as the corpus cavernosum, corpora cavernosa. The plural is corpora cavernosa. You can see here. So there is this erectile tissue here, which is going from one of the pubic bones on one side into the penis and forming the body of the penis. Similarly, on this side, you can see corpora cavernosum or corpus cavernosum. Singular is corpus cavernosum. So together, along with this purple colored structure, that is the corpus spongiosum. Okay, corpus means body, and these leg-like structures are called crura or crust of the penis, and this is the root of the penis. Together is called the root of the penis. The central part is this bulbous structure or the enlarged structure, which is slightly enlarged, that is called the enlarged structure is called the bulbospongiosus, okay, or bulb of the penis, which is covered by bulbospongiosus muscle. Okay, so that is the free part or the attached part here, and the free part which is around here, that is made up of the two corpora cavernosa and one corpus spongiosum. The corpus spongiosum extends and forms the glands of the penis, which winds around and covers the two corpora cavernosa as well, and in the middle there is a slit like opening which is the external urethral orifice. So all these structures are covered by a little bit of smooth muscle and some skeletal muscle for the beginning. So the muscle which is covering the corpora cavernosa is called the ischiocavernosus muscle, and the muscle which is covering the bulb of the penis is called the bulbospongiosus muscle. Okay, and corpus spongiosum, that's the glands of the penis. This is the prepuce, okay, which covers the glands of the penis. and on either side and above the corpus spongiosum are the two corpora cavernosa. These structures are in turn covered by a tough layer of connective tissue sheath, which is called the tunica albuginea. Okay, and each of them have arteries running through and through them. So the deep artery and helicine arteries of the penis are present in the body of the penis. They enter the penis and they supply the erectile tissue, and in the process of erection, what happens is, because there are some muscles, smooth muscles around these veins and the body of the penis, they contract and they increase the pressure so much that it prevents the venous return from the penis from going back into the systemic circulation. So veins are occluded, but the pressure is not so high as to limit the arterial flow, because arterial flow is at a higher pressure of maybe you can say up to 120 millimeters of mercury. As you know, blood pressure goes up to 120 millimeters of mercury. So arterial blood will keep coming into these erectile spongy tissues, but veins cannot take the blood back because they are completely closed off by the smooth muscle contraction. So arterial blood will keep accumulating and it causes engorgement of those venous sinuses that results in erection of the penis. Okay, coming to the root, is situated in the superficial perineal pouch. It is composed of three masses of erectile tissue, the central bulb and the two crura. Each crus is firmly attached to the margins of the pubic arch and covered by the ischiocavernosus, which I already told you, and the crura continue anteriorly into the body of the penis. And bulb is situated between the two crura and it is attached to the perineal membrane and covered by the bulbospongiosus muscle. Okay, and bulb continues anteriorly into the body of the penis as a corpus spongiosum, and bulb is pierced by the urethra, which shows the dilatation called intrabulbar fossa, and urethra then passes through the entire length of the corpus spongiosum. Body or the free portion is continuous with the root, and it's again composed of three cylindrical bodies, or the continuation of the three cylindrical bodies of the root, and the erectile tissue are enclosed in a dense fibrous tissue called the tunica albuginea, then the deep fascia and the skin. Skin is very thin and it is of a higher pigmentation, slightly more darker than your rest of the body skin, and it has no hair follicles and it has no sweat glands usually, and the corpora cavernosa are arranged side by side in the dorsal part of the penis, and corpus spongiosum lies ventrally and it contains the spongy urethra, and at the distal end of the body is the glans penis, which consists entirely of corpus spongiosum, and the concavity of that glans covers the free blunt ends of the corpora cavernosa, and glans of the penis is richly innervated and it is highly sensitive to stimulation or touch, and there is a slit like opening of the spongy urethra called the external urethral orifice near the tip of the glans penis. A prepuce is the skin and fascia of the penis prolonged as free fold, which covers the glans to a variable extent. And the root and glans feel spongy when the penis is flaccid because they are composed of cavernous erectile tissue. Consists of interlacing and intercommunicating spaces which are filled with blood in the erectile position or erect position. The weight of the penis is supported by the two ligaments that are continuous with the fascia of the penis, which are called the fundiform ligament, which arises from the linea alba, and then the suspensory ligament of the penis, which arises from the pubic symphysis. So the arteries are branches of the internal pudendal artery, and veins drain into the internal pudendal vein or internal iliac veins. Okay, so these are deep artery of the penis and the dorsal artery of the penis, which are branches of the internal pudendal artery. The veins have a corresponding name and they drain via the prostatic venous plexus into the internal iliac veins. And nerve supply, sensory nerve is the pudendal nerve, with basically the dorsal nerve of penis, which is a branch of the pudendal nerve. Motor innervation is by the perineal and pudendal nerves. Autonomic is from pelvic plexus. The sympathetic is vasoconstrictor and parasympathetic is vasodilator. The parasympathetic is derived from the S2, S3 and S4, and that is responsible for these sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation is responsible for bringing about erection in the males. Lymphatic drainage from the glands of the penis, it drains into the deep group of inguinal lymph nodes. Rest of the penis drains into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. So these are different layers of the penis. You can see that is the corpus spongiosum in the ventral aspect, and these are the two corpora cavernosa with deep arteries of the penis and the dorsal arteries of penis here, and they are enclosed in a thick fibrous coat which is called the tunica albuginea, and the lower part or the ventral part is called the corpus spongiosum, and in the center there is the urethra. Okay, all of this is covered by deep fascia and then the skin, thin skin, and there are lot of nerves and blood vessels in the. So that's about the penis, and as I already told you, so male is sexually stimulated, then the parasympathetic stimulation happens, which causes muscles in the hallucin artery to relax, the artery straighten and their lumen enlarges, and so the cavernous sinuses are filled with blood, they dilate and become rigid. Meanwhile, the ischiocavernous and bulbous sponges compress the venous plexus at the periphery of the corpora cavernosa, preventing the venous return. And then following the ejaculation, sympathetic stimulation causes constriction of the muscles in the hallucin artery. Ischiocavernosus and bulbous spongiosus relax, increasing the venous return and penis become placid. Okay. Applied aspects, hypospadias. While the penis is developing in the embryo, majority of the times it develops normally. In rare circumstances, the opening and closing of the, basically it develops as two parts and they fuse together and ultimately become one, and they should, the urethra then develops as a cord of cells, and then those cells undergo degeneration or apoptosis and become a tube. But if that process doesn't happen properly, then the urethral orifice, instead of opening at the glands of the penis, can open somewhere before. That is called hypospadias. Okay, it's a common malformation of the penis and urethra. And phimosis is the prepuce, that skin covering the penis cannot be retracted, and when it cannot be retracted, it can cause infection to develop, and sometimes it can cause severe enlargement of the enlargement of the glands and can lead to gangrene. So phimosis, when it is causing problem, can needs to be corrected by circumcision. Okay, so circumcision is the surgical removal of the prepuce. Coming to the scrotum, it's a loose cutaneous fibromuscular sac which is situated in the posterior inferior aspect of the penis and inferior to the pubic symphysis, and it is composed of skin and artose muscle. The muscle, smooth muscle, which is part of the scrotum, which forms scrotum, is called the artose muscle. Artose muscle is firmly attached to the skin, consists of smooth muscle, and contract under influence of cold and exercise and sexual stimulation. And externally, ridge on the scrotum called the raphe divide the scrotum into two equal halves. And the layers of scrotum include the skin, artose muscle, external spermatic fascia, the cremastic fascia, and the internal spermatic fascia. So these are the layers of the scrotum which you should remember. Okay, it may be asked as a question, enumerate the layers of scrotum or enumerate the layers of testes. If the question is enumerate the coverings of the testes, then you have to include all the layers that form the scrotum. Okay, if the question is enumerate the layers of testes, then you will have to mention only the layers of the testes, which will discuss a little later. So as you can see, that is the skin. Then under the skin you have the dartos muscle, okay. Then you have the spermatic fascia, okay, external spermatic fascia, then the cremastic fascia, then internal spermatic fascia, then you have the tunica vaginalis, okay. So these are the different layers of the scrotum, and scrotum is the place where the testis lies. Basically it is the sac which houses the testis and enables the testis to hang loose from the body, so that the temperature of the testis is maintained at a lower level than the core body temperature. The nerve supply, anterior 1/3 is supplied by the L1 segment through the ilioinguinal and genitofemoral nerves, and posterior 2/3 is supplied by the pudendal nerve. Lymphatic drainage into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes contains our testis, epididymis and lower part of the subarachnoid cords. Function is to contraction of the dartos muscle, cremastic muscle causes the testis to be drawn against the body or to suspend. When these relax, testis is suspended so that heat loss can be increased and lower temperature can be maintained. In hot weather, the scrotum relaxes, allowing the testis to hang freely away from the body, and it helps in dissipation of the heat. And these reflexes are in response to temperature and help to maintain the stable temperature required for spermatogenesis. The spermatogenesis to happen, the temperature has to be maintained around 32 degrees in the scrotum. Okay, so that is the testis on both the sides. You can see there are a lot of veins that go from the testis, so there is rich blood supply to the testis as well. Coming to the testis, these are pairs of male gonads, or the definitive genital organs, which determine the sex of the person. These are ovoid in shape and homologous with ovary of the female. You can compare this with the ovaries of the females, because ovaries produce eggs or ovum, and testis produce the sperms, which are responsible for reproduction. These are suspended in the scrotum by the spermatic cord. They lie obliquely with upper pole directed forwards and laterally, and lower pole directed slightly backwards and medially. And usually left testis may be at a lower level than the right, and each testis measures about 5 cm in length, 2.5 cm in diameter, and 3 cm in thickness, and each testis may weigh between 10 to 15 grams in an adult. Okay, and you can see the testis is made up of these large number of seminiferous tubules which join together and come together at the mediastinum testis as the reedy testis, and from there multiple tubules go and they join and form a single coiled structure which is called the epididymis, and this epididymis will continue up as the vas deferens. So there are two poles to the testis, upper and lower pole. Then there are two borders, anterior border and posterior border, and there are two surfaces, medial and lateral surface, because it is slightly squished or flattened from side to side when you look at it from the side. There are three layers of the testis: the tunica vaginalis, which is the outermost layer, then the tunica albuginea, which is the middle layer, which is the thickest and white layer, shining, glistening and shiny, that is why it is called albuginea. Then you have the tunica vasculosa, which is the vascular layer which supplies the blood to the testis. Okay, so you have the tunica vaginalis on the outside. Then the thick white fibrous structure is the tunica albuginea, and on the inside of the tunica albuginea you have the tunica vasculosa. So total coverings of the testis will include skin, dartos muscle, external spermatic fascia, then the cremastic fascia, then comes the internal spermatic fascia, then tunica vaginalis, tunica albuginea, tunica vasculosa. Okay, so how is the structure of the testis? It is made up of 200 to 300 lobules which contain the spermatic or seminiferous tubules. Each lobule, there are 1 to 4 convoluted loops composed of germinal epithelial cells called the seminiferous tubules, and seminiferous tubules contain two types of cells, the spermatogenic cells or the stem cells which are responsible for production of the sperms, and then the supporting cells which are called Sertoli cells. Okay, and between these loops of seminiferous tubules, there are interstitial cells which are responsible for production of hormones. Okay, within the lobule spaces between the seminiferous tubules are connective tissue and blood vessels, lymphatics, nerves, and the interstitial cells of Leydig. The interstitial cells of Leydig lie in the connective tissue, and these have endocrine function. They secrete testosterone. So, seminiferous tubules join to form the straight tubules, and these straight tubules unite to form the efferent ductules, and this pass from the testis into the epididymis, and from the epididymis, the epididymis basically continues from the lower end of the testis as a vas deferens. So you can see that is a basement membrane of the germinal epithelium. This is seen in the seminiferous tubules. The baseline, these are the stem cells, okay, which result in which divide to give rise to another stem cell and one spermatogonia. The primary spermatogonia then migrate up, and then they become spermatocyte. The spermatocyte is committed, and once it is committed, it will only multiply to give rise to 4 spermatids. Okay, so then there is secondary spermatocyte will undergo further division, and it will give rise to finally the spermatids. Okay, and then these spermatids mature and then become spermatozoa. Okay, the spermatogonia, primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte to spermatids and spermatids. So this is the actual micro photograph of the seminiferous tubules, showing the basement membrane here, and then there are some connective tissue cells and smooth muscle cells. Then there are these baseline cells or the stem cells. Okay, then in between you can see the cells are becoming larger, and then they become smaller and smaller as they divide, and they give rise to these spermatids and spermatozoa. And these spermatids are maturing, and they are attached to the Sertoli cells. Okay, so spermatogenesis, there are 3 phases: the spermatogonial phase, where there is mitosis. The spermatogonia proliferate by mitotic division to produce stem cells and cells which produce through the spermatogenesis. They result in spermatocytes and another spermatogonial cells or the stem cell. Then the spermatocyte phase undergoes meiosis, which results in diploid cells. That is, each chromosome, there are 2 copies of each chromosome. They get divided. The chromosomes get divided into 2 different cells, daughter cells. Okay, 2n becomes 1n. That is, diploid state becomes haploid state, and that reduction division of meiosis 1 happens, and then meiosis 2 happens, where there is equatorial division. The DNA that is replicated, the chromosomes that had replicated, will separate into individual spermatogonia or spermatids. Okay, so spermatid phase is the spermiogenesis, and from here the spermatids undergo further maturation, and they differentiate into spermatozoa. Okay, so that is a spermatogenesis. Okay, and spermiogenesis is the maturation of the sperm. It's 60 microns long and acquires full motility in the epididymis and in the female genitalia. It has a head, neck, and tail. The head consists of the genetic material. Then the neck part is narrower, and then there are lot of mitochondria, and there is this motility part which whips like the flagellum. Basically, the tail has a middle piece and the remaining part, which basically rotates like a spiral, like a screw, and propels the sperm forward. Okay, the principal piece is the longer piece, and the middle piece is the piece which contains the cytoskeletal elements and the mitochondria that are responsible for bringing about motility. Maturation of the sperm, basically the sperm leaving the testis and entering the epididymis are non-motile and not capable of fertilization. The sperm acquire motility and final maturation as they leave through the or travel through the epididymis, and they become capacitated and able to fertilize the ovum only in the female genital tract. So the time span of sperm development, it takes about 70 days to develop from spermatogonia into spermatozoa, and it takes another 14 days to travel through the epididymis to the ejaculatory duct. Illness and exposure to toxic agents can have delayed effect on the quality of sperm produced. Okay, so spermatozoa has to travel all the way from here, and the epithelium, because they are not motile, the epithelium lining the epididymis and seminiferous tubules or the efferent ductules, epididymis and the vas deferens may contain stereocilia or cilia which are responsible for pushing the spermatozoa in the vas deferens. Blood supply to the testis is derived from the testicular artery, which is a direct branch from the abdominal aorta, meaning the testis and the ovum basically develop in the abdominal cavity during the embryological development. So as they are developing, they receive blood supply directly from the abdominal aorta. Okay, but the testis descends down into the scrotum later on, so it brings with it the artery. So the testicular artery is derived from the abdominal aorta, and venous drainage basically forms a plexus of veins and drains on the right side directly into the abdominal aorta, and on the left side it drains into the renal vein. Okay, nerve supply by the 10th thoracic spinal nerve. Okay, lymphatic drainage is through the pre-aortic and para-aortic lymph nodes. Okay, so testis develops in the abdomen and gradually descends, and at birth it is present in the scrotum. So because it descends, develops somewhere else and descends, sometimes if the descent doesn't complete, then there may be absence of testis within the scrotum, but the testis may be arrested somewhere, so that requires surgical descent or surgical correction later on. Okay, that undescended testis is called cryptorchidism. Okay, and hydrocele is accumulation of fluid through the processus vaginalis, and ectopic testis is found in perineum, root of the penis, or femoral triangle. So while it is descending, if it doesn't go into the scrotum, then it may end up in the root of the penis or femoral triangle, that is called ectopic testis. And torsion of the testis, because the testis is hanging loose in the scrotum, it may get twisted, that is called torsion of the testis, and it results in obstruction of the blood flow leading to gangrene and sudden, it is an emergency, it needs to be corrected urgently. Coming to the epididymis, it is a tubular structure which lies along the upper pole of the and posterior border of each testis. It is a comma shaped organ about 4 cm long, and it contains different ducts from the testis which join together to form the ductus epididymis at the largest superior portion of the epididymis, which is called the head. So upper part of the epididymis is called the head, and the body is the narrow mid portion of the epididymis, and sperms are stored here, undergo final stage of maturation, and then the tail is a smaller inferior portion which continues with the ductus deferens. So this is the head, that is the body, that is the tail of the epididymis, and then the vas deferens begins. The ductus epididymis would measure about 6 meters in length if uncoiled. If you fully elongate it, it will measure 6 meters. It is lined with pseudostratified columnar epithelium encircled by layers of smooth muscles. The spermatic, coming to spermatic cord, it suspends the testis in the scrotum and consists of structures running to and from the testis. It begins at the deep inguinal ring, passes through the inguinal canal, and emerges at the superficial inguinal ring and descends within the scrotum to the testis and ends at the posterior border of the testis. And it contains ductus deferens, testicular artery, cremastic artery, and artery to the ductus deferens, pampiniform plexus, lymphatic vessels from the testis, then genital branch with the genitofemoral and sympathetic plexus from which accompany the testicular artery. Then it, if there is a remnant of process vaginalis, then that process of vaginalis will also remain in the spermatic cord. So that is the spermatic cord, which takes structures into the abdomen or brings structures from the abdomen into the testis, because testis developed in the abdomen, so it has to have connection with the abdomen. So there are three layers which cover the spermatic cord, which is called the external spermatic fascia, derived from the external oblique muscle, cremastic fascia, which is basically derived from internal oblique, and the internal spermatic fascia, which is derived from the fascia transversalis. Cremaster is a combined muscle. It has part of the skeletal muscle as well as smooth muscle, and when you scratch the inner side of the thigh in a male, then there may be a reflex contraction of the cremaster, resulting in the testis jumping up. That reflex is called cremastic reflex. Okay, so these are the coverings of the spermatic cord contents. Varicocele refers to a condition where the pampiniform plexus, these plexus of veins that you can see in the spermatic cord, sometimes if they get obstructed somewhere in the abdomen, then they get dilated, and that dilatation and tortuosity of the pampiniform plexus is called varicocele, and it feels like a bag of worms, and it is more common on the left side. Okay, and ductus deferens is also called vas deferens. It is a thick walled muscular tube, and ductus deferens is about 45 centimeters in length. If you recall, there are many structures which have 45 centimeters length. One of them is esophagus, another one is your spinal cord, then one more is a muscle which is in the thigh, which is called the sartorius muscle, and the other structure which is about 45 centimeters in length is this ductus deferens. It begins at the tail of the epididymis and runs in the scrotum and inguinal canal, and it leaves the spermatic cord at the deep inguinal ring and enters the greater pelvis, and it passes backward and medially to enter the lesser pelvis, and it crosses the ureter near the bladder and ends by joining the duct of the seminal vesicle to form the ejaculatory duct. The dilated terminal portion of the ductus is the ampulla, and functionally the ductus deferens conveys sperms from the epididymis towards the urethra by peristaltic contraction of muscular coat. So that is the ductus deferens going here through the spermatic cord and the inguinal canal and going behind the bladder, joining with the seminal vesicles. You can see that is the ductus deferens, and then there is ampulla here, dilatation, then it joins with the duct of the seminal vesicle to form the ejaculatory duct. So ductus deferens, when you take a cross section and examine under microscope, it contains large number of smooth muscle fibers, then pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium in the lumen, covering the lumen, that forms the mucosa, and it will contain sperms and it will push the sperms. So there are three layers. Mucous membrane or the mucosa consists of columnar epithelium or the lamina propria star shape, then the middle muscular is very thick, and the outer connective tissue is there. Okay, vasectomy is cutting the vas deferens and it is a common method of sterilization in males. And there is a small incision that is made in the superficial part of the scrotum, and two difference ducts or ductus difference are located and then tied at two sides. Okay, they are cut. Okay, between the two sides, it is cut and excised or taken out, and the sperm production continues. So they will degenerate in epididymis and proximal part of the vas deferens. If required, recanalization can be done, but it is little difficult. Coming to the seminal vesicles, these are the paired structures behind the urinary bladder. The seminal glands are convoluted pouch-like structures about 5 cm in length, lying behind the base of the urinary bladder and anterior to the rectum. Secretes an alkaline viscous fluid that contains fructose, prostaglandins and clotting proteins, and the fluid provides most of the volume of the semen, and the sperms are not stored in this structure. Okay, so that is a seminal vesicle. It produces most of the semen, that thick viscous fishy smelling fluid which is ejaculated after sexual intercourse, is mostly produced in the seminal vesicles, but it is joined by the sperms in the ductus deferens, vas deferens. So it comes out along with the sperms, but seminal vesicles are not responsible for storing the sperms. Each ejaculatory duct is about 2 cm long and is formed by the union of the duct from the seminal vesicles and ampulla of the ductus deferens, and it passes through the prostate and opens by a slit like opening into the posterior wall of the prostatic urethra on each side of the prostatic utricle. Coming to the prostate gland, the prostate gland is a single donut shaped gland about the size of a golf ball, basically about 15 grams, measures about 15 grams, and it is largest accessory gland of the male reproductive system. It is fibromusculoglandular tissue, so that means it has fibrous tissue, then it has muscular tissue, then there is glandular tissue. Okay, and it measures about 4 centimeters from side to side and about 3 centimeters from top to bottom and about 2 centimeters from front to back, and measures anywhere between 8 to 15 grams. And it lies in the pelvic cavity in front of the rectum and behind the symphysis. Pubis just below the neck of the bladder. It has a base, apex, anterior surface, posterior surface and two lateral surfaces. And this is the urinary bladder. That's the neck of the urinary bladder, and urethra begins here. So this, the musculature of the urinary bladder. Then the urethra passes or crosses the urinary bladder, immediately enters the prostate. So the prostate is like this on either side of the urethra. Okay, and into that middle portion you have the ejaculatory ducts opening. Okay, and there is a elevation in the urethra within the prostatic part, which is called the verum montanum. Okay, this prostate undergoes degenerative changes as you get older, and the commonest condition that affects the prostate is called the benign prostatic hypertrophy. Okay, benign prostatic hypertrophy, and sometimes cancers can also develop, which are called prostatic cancers. Okay, it consists of an item out of fibrous covering and a layer of smooth muscles and glandular substance composed of columnar epithelial cells, and secretions of the prostate enters the prostatic urethra through many prostatic ducts. There are two capsules, the inner capsule which is made up of connective tissue, and the outer false capsule is made up of pelvic fascia, and the prostatic venous plexus lies between the two layers of capsules. There are lobes, usually you describe 5 lobes, but need not be always 5 lobes. Okay, as you grow older, the lobes become indistinct. The urethra passes through the gland vertically, and two ejaculatory ducts pierce the prostate gland and open into the posterior surface of the urethra. Okay, and the posterior lobe is the most commonly involved one in the cancer, and median lobe is commonly involved in the benign tumors, that is BPH. Relations will obviously superiorly neck of the bladder, inferiorly urogenital diaphragm. Anterior surface is related to the body of the pubis, and posterior surface is related to the terminal portion of vas deferens and seminal vesicles. and lateral surface is overlapped by the levator ana. So there is levator ana like this, and this is the pelvic diaphragm here. So lower part there is pelvic diaphragm, above there is neck of the bladder, then on the sides you will have the levator ana muscle, behind you will have the seminal vesicles and ejaculatory ducts or the vas deferens. Applied aspects, I already told you, BPH and cancer. As a treatment, we do prostatectomy or transurethral resection of prostate. Okay, bulbourethral glands are also called Koppers glands, are paired and are about the size of peas, and they are located inferior to the prostate on either side of the membranous urethra. Coming to the urethra now, it serves as a passageway for both semen and urine, and it is about 20 centimeters in length. It passes through the prostate and deep muscles of the perineum, and the penis is divided in and penis, and it is divided into three parts: the prostatic urethra, which is about 2 to 3 centimeters in length, and this continues inferiorly and passes through the muscles of the perineum, where it is called the membranous urethra. Then membranous urethra is just 1 centimeter long. So this is the membranous urethra. Okay, this 1 centimeter long part is called the membranous urethra, which passes through the pelvic diaphragm, and the part which is in the urethra, the prostate, is called the prostatic urethra. Then the part which is in the penis is called the penile urethra. Okay, so this part is a penile urethra, that is the prostatic, membranous and penile urethra. So then this passes through the corpus spongiosum of the penis, as I told you already, in the penis, and it is known as the spongy urethra, which is about 15 to 20 centimeters in length, and the spongy urethra ends at the external urethral orifice. So that completes the male reproductive system. So hope you have been able to understand. I had to rush through a lot of stuff, but unfortunately, there is nothing much that can be done in this, and you don't need things in such great detail. What I have covered is more than sufficient for you.